Hi people, welcome back to the control room with myself, MLavontelle, and the incredible...
Oh, myself, Chris the Capo. You're finally back.
I'm back. Oh, I'm back, baby. I'm here. I'm in the building. One episode about me.
Shout out Alex Bass.
Two.
Yeah, you know, shout out Alex Bass.
You know, it's mad. When you was like the incredible, I was excited. I was like, rah, go on.
Hold that thought.
I was like, how nice you gonna be.
And we have a phenomenal guest.
Yes.
The man himself. Yes. Award winning.
Yes.
That sounds good. That's got a ring to it.
Yeah.
Appreciate it.
Dope projects out. Oh, it's Avelino, everybody.
I love that.
Was that good?
I appreciate that. Trust me. You know what I mean, after that one there, that little situation,
it was meaty,
I
was like, isn't
yo,
it?
No, not even that. When you said the incredible, I was like, yo, thank you.
Definitely, when we are speaking of wordsmiths, speaking about top tier lyricists, when you're speaking about even longevity within the music as well, within the sound, it's definitely you, and also someone respectfully that we have to say, and that hasn't been mentioned by the masses, but needs to be mentioned in sense of where a very, very strong album. Very, very strong album, especially in this day and age of where a lot of people complain and say that there's albums that may feel like fast food or things along those lines. God Save the Streets.
Yes.
Independent. Number 12, it peaked in the charts.
Yes.
Big congratulations, first and foremost.
Yeah. Thank you, I appreciate that a lot.
Features as well coming from Wretch. Coming from Getz, Row G, RA, Tiggs the Author, as well as that, also the bonus tracks with Tef
and Blanco.
And Blanco.
Progression was on there.
Progression as well, yes. Speak to us, God Save the Streets. Speak to us about it.
So obviously, it's a privilege, you know what I mean? It's been a while since I've been doing music. My debut album took a minute to get here because I believe, you know, your music can never be any like more or less than who you are as a person, you get me? So I had to get to the place in life where I even had enough sort of insight to even deliver a project such as God Save the Streets, you know what I mean? It's a big title and it's not about talent, you know what I mean? You gotta get to the point in life where it's more than about talent, it's more about your perspective. And, you know, coming from where I'm coming from, you know, I felt like, you know, I had the tools and the skills and the feelings to do the title justice, you know? And that's why it was time.
But you have the talent and you have more than the talent. So what other kind of elements do you feel like you needed to add over, you know, maybe just life experience?
Composure. So a composure perspective, you know, because it's like almost like that relationship with the struggle. I feel like our general relationship with the struggle is that it's a bad thing. You know what I mean? The struggle is a bad thing. But it's like over time, I came to understand that, you know, without poverty, without the struggle, I wouldn't be who I am today. You know, it's you look at people, you look at the qualities we kind of get growing up, where we grow up in the streets or whatever, like you apply it to a different area in life and those people fly, you know. And I guess with God Save the Streets, you know, my message overall is change your mind, change your life. And it sounds cliche, but I guess the most cliche sayings are the most powerful. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? When someone says anything you can do and anything you put your mind to, you can do. It sounds, in one ear, out the other, but it's like, yo, I'm using an iPhone, that's Steve Jobs, you know what I mean? Or I'm in a car, that's flipping Henry Ford. I'm on a plane, that's the Wright brothers. And, you know, they didn't see that saying as a joke thing, you know what I mean? So, you know, we can be anyone we want to be, and coming from where we're coming from, that's not always something that we truly deep down believe, you know? We fall victim to the vicious cycle, you know? It's like, there's only a few outcomes we have. I call it unholy trinities, where it's like we either die, go jail, or we definitely don't have peace of mind. You know what I mean? It's one of the three. And I guess God Save the Streets was me speaking to and for the streets, saying that it doesn't have to be that way. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. One of the key things you mentioned in, I forgot what song it was, where you said, I'm coming from T, so it's short for trauma.
Mm-hmm.
Where you mentioned that. And obviously you're seeing everything that's happening at this moment of time.
Yeah.
It's like, what would you think is the best way to speak to the streets aside from just the music? What is it a way that we can, unfortunately we've seen what's happened in Croydon, you're seeing that these constant, every single day, it's like we're waking up and seeing a new story of, you know, a murder or anything that's happening within the inner city. What do you think is that actually is that could speak to the streets and give that message that they need?
I feel like we're all 1%, you know. I don't feel like I have the power to, you know, clip my fingers and make everything better. But I guess I always say, like, the best type of leader I ever saw, someone that led by example, you get me? So the best thing I could do is keep achieving and keep, you know, bringing people from my trenches around me. And, you know, I mean, when I was doing God Save the Streets and we got the number 12 or whatnot, I really had the streets, like, you know, doing the graft with me. You know what I mean? People who maybe are more used to an environment that doesn't have the purpose that aim and objective on that week and beyond gave them. And it was great to see, like, just a positive task and a sort of collective aim, have all these guys in a different frame of mind, you know? And a lot of times a young person ain't gonna know that something's possible if they don't see something other than what they're used to. Enough, man, life ain't bigger than their estate or their block or their, you know what I mean? So all I can do really is keep using my skills and my talent and the gifts that I'm living through to shed light on what I feel my people needs or society needs, and just keep achieving, keep winning, keep flying, because, you know, maybe that changes someone's life, just seeing me do my thing, you know what I mean? Dreams save lives, dreams definitely save mine, you know what I mean? Seeing Wretch Free 2 go number one in the charts when I'm local, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Maybe doing things I shouldn't be doing, it's like, wow, like, it's one thing seeing Dizzy Rascal do it. I was speaking with him the other day and I'm like, it was amazing to see, it kind of puts a battery in your back. But when someone down the road is doing stuff like that, you almost feel charged up like you couldn't ever be in any other way. But it's like, when it's right there, you can see this is possible. And that person makes an effort to come back to the community and boom, 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 you can interact with them. And it's like, yo, you know, dreams are not a waste of time. You get me? So for me, in terms of what you asked, all I can do is continue to be great. You know what I mean? Being great is just embracing the power of your mind, you know what I mean, and continuously living through that, you know what I mean? Yeah.
Makes a lot of sense. Mm. Even speaking about I like to call him like the sensei in your community.
Yeah.
Of Wretch Free 2.
Come on.
By the way, Wretch, I'm still waiting on this new album because he's been killing it for about almost 2 years.
Yeah.
Collabs, it's and coming, features, coming. Verses. Just speak to us about, obviously, we know how well that you guys have worked with each other, Young Fire, Old Flame, classic.
Appreciate it.
Speak to us about that first session with you two and even the process of how you even got to know each other.
So the first session on Young Fire Flame or in general?
Yeah.
So general. I remember. So I was with my cousin Gmo, rest in peace. I buried him last weekend, yeah.
Rest in peace.
What was it? So 3-2's just shouted me. Obviously, I know 3-2. I don't know him because we're different generations, two totally different age groups, but we're locals. And I don't remember exactly how he got it. I think he got my number of Hurricane Hunt, another rapper from my area. And he just reached out to me, come studio, you know? And obviously, yo, I'm recording in my brethren's yard in the wardrobe, the mic's in the wardrobe, and we're just slapping out recordings and uploading it to the online world, you know what I mean? Just to say, yo, we do music. So there's a big jump. Rich is, you know, a number one artist, you get me? So I remember going there and just kind of being like, yo, I'm someone who's always had like mad self-belief even from before I met Rich. Like, I just go in it. I go, because this is, I put music in the category of sort of, I'm going to sleep, otherwise I'll pass away. I'm going to eat, otherwise I'll pass away eventually. I'm going to drink water, because if I don't, I'm going to pass away eventually. Music, I'll die too, but inside, you know what I mean? So I'm going to do it regardless. So I've gone there, embraced the challenge. We've made some music. The tune was awful, or my part was anyway, which is fine. But I guess it raised my level again, just seeing 3-2's level and, you know, just everything he'd achieved. You go there and he's from the same place. He's got the chains. Mm. You know what I mean? We're leaving in the G-Wagon and yo,
it's lit.
That's it for me now. We're going for it. We're gonna change our lives. That's it. And I know it's possible because I'm sitting right next to the guy.
Mm. What did working with Wretch teach you about yourself? Did he teach you anything personally?
I think it showed me that I had a lot of growing to do as a human being. You know what I mean? Just in terms of understanding myself, learning myself. Because I felt like as soon as I met 3-2, he kind of was very sure about who he was. And, you know, what he brought to the game in terms of what he was rapping about, etc. But obviously I was very young, which is only natural, you get me. But I think it kind of did verify to me that my fearlessness, you know what I mean? I've always been fearless and ambitious. I don't, you know, I'm ready for a challenge. And I think, you know, being talented is one thing, but I always say to young people, it's not so important, you get me? I don't believe being talented alone is why after all these years, you know, you guys would still invite me down to have a chat, and I just made my debut album. It's not about talent, you know what I mean? Even in the world of sports or whatever, like, talent is only can only do so much. Mm-hmm. Some of the best footballers I've ever seen, you ain't never watched them on Match of the Day, do you know what I mean? So I guess, you know, it let me know that I had a quality that was necessary to be crazy enough to keep going, you know, mm-hmm. and make a career, basically, you know, so... I guess, yeah, the fact that there was more growth to do as a person, Rich taught me, or showed me. But then also the fact that I had what it took, the craziness to just live through music and go again and again and again. You've got to be crazy. Otherwise, it's just not going to make sense. You know what I mean? You've got to have, without passion, passion kind of allows you to kind of bypass or overlook rationale, you know what I mean?
Very true.
You know what I mean? Because giving up or stopping always makes sense.
Yeah, yeah.
It always the logical thing to do.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But then when you care about something or you got passion or burning desire, I rather call it.
That's the one, burning
desire.
Yeah,
burning desire. When you got that, it's like it's enough to be crazy.
Yeah.
I feel like as if that burning desire and that passion was very prominent from the beginning with you, because even from like Young Fire, Old Flame was sort of like the pass the torch moment.
I guess
if
so,
that makes sense.
Yeah, yeah.
And funny enough, is like I mentioned earlier on with introducing you, was then mentioning the key word longevity. You look at that class that you entered the scene with around 2015, you might be, besides from Storms, you two might be the only ones that are still here and still very relevant and still flourishing very well within your career. Have you ever took a step back to realize that and actually think, okay, what was it that made us still be here? And secondly, no disrespect to the others, but why did they fall off?
And would you agree with that?
Yeah, I think there's so many factors, man, in terms of what we're discussing just now, you know. I always go back to, I always look at losing my old man at 14, 15, I was, as the reason why I have unlimited, like, it's like the worst thing that's ever happened to you could turn out to be the best thing that's ever happened to you, depending on how you look at it, you know what I mean? And we should be sitting here talking about how devastating and how catastrophic losing your old man is, but losing my old man is the catalyst to everything. It's given me an unlimited source of motivation. Avelino's my surname and I made it my stage name to do my old man proud, you know what I mean? And that never stops, you got what I mean? So I guess it just depends. It's all, there's always going to be so many variables. I can look at my own personal life and see that as a big part, you know, as to why I'm still here, just going at it. I've just got, you know, I think that, like, dad's playing an important part in young men's lives, you get me? They're playing an important part when they're present, you know what I mean? Because, you know, I think, and obviously, I was just talking about this with my mate earlier, and it's like, you know, unfortunately, you know, we're in a generation where a lot of, you know, you find that dads ain't around for whatever reason, which is unfortunate. And then you get, you know, great mothers who step up to the plate and play both roles, you know, which is great. But, you know, it's not ideal, because in an ideal world, you know, a kid will have his mum and his dad, because I think, you know, generally, you know, women are amazing at nurturing, and, you know, you hold a kid for 9 months, you know, you want to keep it soft and look after it and protect it for as long as possible. Whereas I think generally a man sort of like sets the targets, sets the mentality, challenges, you get me? And I always say my old man done his job. He didn't need to spend another year. You know what I mean? He done his job, like everything, all the time I spent with him, all the lessons he taught me still run through my head to this day, you know what I mean? So, and I'm grateful for that. So, and so in terms of what you asked, I know my variables. I can't really speak for other people. I know why I could keep going and I'm never gonna stop. It's like things that have happened, innit, that I've used to my advantage rather than let hold me back. And it's that thing where I speak on this kind of way of thinking where I say bad things are going to happen, but in all those bad things, there's like a potential blessing. And I say potential because it's not always obvious. You know what I mean? It's not always clearly obvious what that blessing might be, but it's always there. You just got to use your imagination and willpower and believe it and figure it out. You get me? So from where I'm standing, I know that certain things that happen, i.e. certain majors, losing my old man, and I used it as an advantage, and that's kept me going, and it will keep me going for however much longer it needs to. Whereas for other people, I don't know their variables or their situation, or, you know, but I do know that it takes craziness, that as I was talking about, to keep.
Yeah.
That's, without it, it's a myth, you know, without it, it's
that,
a myth.
I think that is it. For working within this industry, like, you need that burning desire, you will quit early.
You'll quit early.
You
know,
quit very
you need
early.
It, you need
but,
it.
But let's talk about the importance of being independent. Obviously, this project was is an independent album, and of course, you won an award the other day at the AIM Independent Music Awards.
Yeah, for you, man.
Oh my God, good, album of the year, best independent album.
I'm happy. I'm happy about it.
Rightfully deserving.
I'm happy
oh my
about
God,
that. Thank
yes.
I appreciate it. I'm very happy about that. I will never lie.
Yeah.
You know.
Can I just say though, because I was there. Your performance,
I held back
the tears.
Serious,
like your speech is when I was
serious.
My God,
yeah,
it was so powerful, so powerful.
I felt
like you just smashed it. By the way,
I appreciate that a lot, man. I felt it was important to do that speech because we're in a room full of people that might not understand our thing. You know what I mean? And then I needed them to know that this ain't no music thing. You know what I mean? This ain't no record sales, thousands of sales. This is thousands of lives that we're used to losing, you get me? And we just think it's normal. Mm-hmm. But, you know, we've transmuted it into music and a project with a message. This is the reality of society where we are today, and I've made a project that I feel reflects that, you know, from my perspective, you get me? Which is what I believe an artist's job is. So I really had to put that out there in the room and make people understand that this ain't no, we sold this much, we should have won the award. This ain't no sales thing, bro. This is real life, you know what I mean? So, yeah.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Yeah, congratulations once again.
Appreciate it.
But also talk to us about being independent, what it's like for you currently.
Costs a lot of money. You know what I mean? It's good, like, obviously, it's just, it felt like the right thing to do. I was at Sony RCA. Mm. Never had no problems over there. You know, good people. At the label, dropped a mixtape, Ego Kills. And I felt, you know, I just had a conversation with the head. I had a conversation with him. I was like, I feel like my next chapter, something's telling me it needs to be, I need to go alone. This is what I need to do for the next step in my career. You know, I walk in faith. So you can't always explain exactly why, but you know, intuition's a beautiful thing in that way, innit? You get me? So. And he was kind enough to just have a think about it and come back to us and say, yeah, cool, we're not going to take up the option and we'll let you, you know, go in that direction. And yeah, like I said, it costs a lot of dough, you know what I mean? But without a solid team, and I'm lucky to have good brothers around me with great talents, you know, coming together, I don't know if great things are possible. I don't know. In any calling, you get me? I don't know if it's possible to... I don't know if any man's ever done anything great on his ones completely. I don't know if it's ever happened, you get me? So, yes, I guess, you know, having a great team's been a blessing, and also being around for a little while in the industry, in the game, and kind of understanding how things work was also a blessing, you get me? Which a brand new artist doesn't always have, you know what I mean? So that was a blessing, just in terms of what we need, having this person in PR, or what PR companies are good, or what this is. I mean, having someone here, or having someone here, having a radio plug, and having two actually, and then boom, 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 and certain relationships at DSPs, and boom, 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 and this and that, and whatever it might be. Mm. Kind of having that understanding of how things work was very helpful as well. You get me? So, you know, and every last detail was cared about. You know, we make a good album and win an award, but it's like, that ain't just me getting on the microphone and rapping, you know what I mean? That's me getting an executive producer who I think is the right one, which was Rich Free, to work with the right producers who I think, who we felt were the right ones. You know, getting Marvin Herbert to come and speak on the album, you know, to getting David Kim to mix it, because he does Nas and Nipsey Hussle and etc. So he understands rap. Getting Ruben Dangor to do the artwork, because he, you know, message and art is synonymous for him. He does, like, you know, he done, like, his first things that got popularity were like the paintings of Skepta on the horse, and you know what I mean. So he's, you know, message and art is his thing as well. So our kind of connection made sense. Or just all these deals and all these people is what it takes to do something great. And then it's in the same sense with the structure of, you know, running our own independent label, like, you know, Doorbell, you know, the PR company, you know, ID85 with the socials, and, you know, Mikey Lloyd and Maurice and all these people, all of these things. And I haven't even mentioned everyone, but all of these things are all the 1% that make the 100%. Yes. And you should never get it twisted. Like, we have this thing where we have this beautiful ignorance that can make us just say, can I swear?
Yeah.
Because that can make us just say, fuck it, and just, yeah, we're going with it, and this is a banger, and boom, 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 boom. Which is beautiful in a way. But then, you know, I think if you add the kind of sort of structures around that sort of energy, you're only going to elevate what you do even more, you get me? So, yeah. 100%.
Power in numbers, indeed.
Yeah, so...
Av, what's your what are your thoughts on the term underrated? When people use it,
surely someone that calls me underrated doesn't underrate me. You know what I mean? I don't get it. I don't get it. Like, bars. If I'm honest, I'm bars. Clearly not. If you're calling me underrated, you must not underrate me.
No, of course.
You know what I mean?
But what are your thoughts on that term?
I'm not sure.
A lot of people use it in the scene.
The only reason why I don't really like it is because I feel like if you adopt it or take it on as an artist, it might make you, not even an artist, as a human, it might make you lazy. I don't give a fuck if I'm underrated, bro. Like, I've got work to do, mate.
Or better.
Why, like, get better?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, imagine if I, before making this album, I sat around with that on my mind. I'm underrated. I should be this. I should be that. Mm. Brother, you shouldn't fucking be anything. Go and make some shit happen, bro. Do you get what I'm trying to say? But we go around entitled thinking we, boom, boom, boom. Yes, I might be unbelievably talented, but great talent doesn't make a great album. Do you get what I'm trying to say? They're not going to give us an award just because you can rap well. It's about much more than that. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So go and get what you...
I don't think that's what people are missing, isn't it? They're not realising that part. That there are so many other pieces in the pie.
So many other...
It's not just talent.
Entitlement's killing my people.
A lot of people that are global stars are like, they've got like crazy branding and marketing and... They do things outside music. They might do acting. They might, you know, it's like a whole, it's like a machine.
Yeah, you feel me?
It's not just, 100%. Oh, because I'm very good at rapping. And people, it's difficult. It's like a tough pill to swallow.
That's a fact.
But that alone is not going to carry you, because there are how many people in this world? Mm. So why would you think you're the only person that's great at rapping?
Exactly. Just be calm. Yeah. Respect the game, bro. Respect life and just get to work, bro.
It's the consistency. I think it's consistency. Maybe top, well, I don't know, maybe like top out of three, like maybe top two.
Of course, yeah. Mm. You've got to
talent
have that.
Maybe number three. I don't know what number one is. Maybe it might be a bit of blessings and God, if people don't believe in God, luck or whatever you want to call it.
Yeah, you got to believe
and
in
or maybe network. Time. Network, maybe number one.
That could be definitely essential. Work ethic more than anything.
Yeah. 100. Well. Yeah. Like, yo, I can't think it comes from a good place when people say that, you know what I mean? But it's not something that I'm interested in, because it's like, what am I going to do with that information?
Exactly.
I'm not going to do anything with it. I've got targets and goals. I need to work towards them and not think just because I've got this talent, things are going to fall on a plate. They're not. I'm going to make things happen, you know what I mean? And everything that's on my journey is just right for me, you get me? And it's as simple as that. You know, there's no such reality as something for nothing. And I think, adopting that mentality, oh, I'm underrated, should be this, should be that. You shouldn't be anything, bro. Like, go and get what you need to, what you want. Go for the things you want. And if I adopted that mentality before, you know, making this album, I'm so sure it wouldn't be sound the way it is, because you got to settle yourself. You got to settle yourself. You got to be humble. You even got to be humble enough to say, I'm not going to do this on my own. I need help. Okay, cool. You can do this. You can do it. You got to be calm, man. And even when you are flying or you are up, you got to be calm, because we're all dispensable. You get me? Be calm. Just enjoy. Be grateful. Be calm.
I remember before the album came out, and even during the period of like when you was promoting the album, you was very vocal in saying this is gonna be the greatest British rap album.
You know what's mad, bro? I remember I done an interview.
Was it the Rolling Stone one?
NME.
Okay, NME, yeah.
So I was NME, these times I used to drink, I don't drink no more, so I'm fresh, right? I'm like, yeah, I'm working on the greatest British rap debut album of all time, you get me? These times I hadn't recorded a thing. I didn't know the what?
That's calling a bluff.
What? Listen, I recorded a thing. I don't even have a title yet. You know what I mean?
That is what you call manifestation. Yeah. Get it out, music.
Literally, I didn't have nothing. But in my heart, I knew that's what I wanted to do. You get me? And, you know, all of that greatest this, greatest that, just leave that to time. And it is what it is. All greatness really is, to me, is just realizing how powerful and how crazy our minds are, embracing it and putting it to use. That's it. Do you get what I'm trying to say? And that to me is greatness. You know what I mean? And I know for a fact that making this album, I'd done everything I could at the time to make the best work I could possibly make. So job done.
That's,
you know
all
what
that
mean?
Matters. That's literally what you could have done.
Yeah,
literally.
That's it. You know, so that's why it's nice to, like, you know, get recognition or accolades. It's beautiful, you know. It's, I'll never lie, it's a good feeling. Yeah, you know what I mean? It's good, it's good, you know.
Do you know what? Because I want to talk about the album, but you mentioned something that was so interesting to me. You actually said the fact of that you stopped drinking. Was there a specific reason why you decided to do this? Or
so my relationship with alcohol is interesting one, because I was alcoholic, bro. Like, let's keep it a buck, you know what I mean? But obviously over the years you use the excuse to yourself, like, oh, no, it's not like I drink when I'm at home. But you're never at home, bro. You know what I mean? So you're an alcoholic, G. Like, let's be real. You know what I mean? That's the, you know what I mean? You're telling yourself, like, the lies we tell ourselves to
just convince ourselves that it's normal.
Gee, it's crazy, you know? Yeah. And obviously my thing was literally no alcohol, no music. I can't create without alcohol. It's a myth. You know what I mean? And that's a decade in that. That's not doesn't sound good over that period of time. You get me? So I remember I cut down heavily whilst making this album. Because I did it by accident, even. You get me? There was a song called Twin Flame, even.
Big tune.
Love, bro. Love. I appreciate that. So that's the first song I really made sober, like, you get me? I remember I had, like, a little window to record it because I had an idea. The song was, there's a completely different song on the beat. It was in a different key before. And I knew I had to change it. But the idea, when the idea came to me, I had to get out of my system. I called my engineer, my brethren. And he only had a 2-hour window to do it. So rushed to the studio and I had to just make that song in 2 hours, literally, bam, 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 bam. And then the next day, I'm listening to it. I'm like, I rang my guy. I'm like, yo, I ain't drink alcohol whilst making this, did I? He's like, nah. And like, something went off in my mind. I was like, what the fuck? That's my, to me, that was crazy. You get me? I've tried it again. Bam, acceptance. I've tried it again. Bam. I'm like, I can't believe. So I don't need this thing. Wow.
I love that.
You get me? So by then, I'd cut down. You know, I'd have completely stopped, like, brown liquors, like Hennessy and all of that. I didn't do that type of stuff no more anyway. But then recently, since my last, kind of around my last birthday, I just allowed it. So, yeah, it's been, you know what I mean? It's been only like maybe like 4 or 5 months or something.
Do you feel any different?
I don't really know. I don't think, you know, I can't really tell. I'm just keeping it moving, you get me? I don't know.
Don't think too much about it.
Yeah, because where I've just stopped, I haven't stopped from being on it. I cut down mad anyway, do you get me? So that's probably why they're different. I don't really feel anything, you get me? But yeah, I just, the decision to stop just now is just, maybe just take a year off or something, some shit. Like,
you know, if you say that now, the next we'll see Av doing push-ups with Rashid, Chucky, Merkston.
Yeah.
Blood. We'll see you in Euro training.
Listen, I'm saying to Rashid, I'm like, yo, I was gassing it up, hyping it up to him and all that. When I see the videos of them lot, doing the training, I said, yeah, love. All them posts I had in the drafts of me training.
Forget.
They're coming down. They're coming down, 100%. I wasn't on it, 100%.
Let's talk about the album. Because what I love with this album more than anything is that it is the right type of social commentary on what's happening within inner city London. And it's like, with these type of albums, usually it's themed in a sense of where you have this titled person and it's following him on these steps or these journeys. But what it is like, you've literally got your pen and your pad out and you're just literally making notes and talking from the perspective of the ends as a whole and every side of it. It's not just, okay, trauma, he's lost the life, he's got into the roles, he's now trapping and stuff and blah, blah, blah. You're talking about the relationship aspect. You're speaking about those who actually battle the 9-to-5 side of things and think, you know what, I want to do this, but my friend who's doing this is benefiting as well. So it's like an overview perspective. Now, firstly, to ask you, what do you think are, if you were to say, the three songs that encapsulate living in inner city London? What do you think those three songs from the album, what do you think that would be?
Boy, for our inner city London, I'd say probably track one. You get me? Probably track one. Encapsulate. Vicious Cycles, probably, yeah.
100%,
well. Damn, what's this song? Yeah, and Vex, just hella angry youths. You know what I mean?
I was going to mention Vex.
Hella angry youths. Yeah. Like, we don't know how to deal with process emotions. You know what I mean? We don't know how to process emotions. We have no understanding of it. We have nothing. Like, you know what I mean? To the point where, you know, a girl's getting stabbed over, I don't know the details of the situation, but supposedly something to do with flowers or...
That's on rejection.
Yeah. On rejection or something. Bro, that's a young person who has no clue how to handle the emotion of rejection to the point where he can do that. Do you get what I'm trying to say? It's only getting worse and worse.
That is What's the problem?
Like, man has no clue. You know, it's a deep. It's more than just, like, it's deep, bro. Like, to do that, over reject that, just shows the scale of where the generations are going. Like, that's a madness. You know what I mean? Vex.
Yeah,
I don't have no clue how to process. It's crazy.
I think I definitely would agree in that sense of you mentioning as well, Sin City.
Yeah, yeah, I love that song. That's my favorite.
Because of Wretch as well.
Yeah, 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 that's my favorite.
This album,
the mastermind.
But also as well, Acceptance. Yeah. I like the way that you ended that as well. It was literally coming to terms of everything and actually having that form of accountability.
Yeah.
Even down towards your writing process, I want to speak to you about this because I'm a person who, I like bars. I like every bar. But it's always been the case of where with you, and I don't know whether it's conscious or subconscious, but you will use like paradoxes in there. So saying a good with a bad, a positive out of a negative.
That's
oxymorons smart. And things like that along those terms and that double on double and triple entendres. Do you go in there subconsciously thinking, okay, this is my writing process of how I want to do this, or is it now just second nature because of obviously being around your peers and having someone like Wretch that you're learning from as well?
Yeah, so in terms of the what you spoke about, the paradox and oxymorons, that's just, you know, rap is something I do. And my job on this earth is to share that way of thinking, philosophy, if you want to call it, you know what I mean? That connection between the good and the bad, it's always there. So it's going to be in every single one of my lyrics, every single one of my conversations, talks that I do at school, every single one of my, you know, if I write a book, if I write a film, if I whatever, it's always going to be there. Do you know what I mean? Like, that's the way of thinking that I'm here to share and like kind of put in front of people, and the lyrics will reflect that always. In terms of the actual writing process, I imagine, so funny enough, you asked me about the first session of Wretch. I haven't written a lyric since that day. You know what I mean? That's the last time I ever wrote a lyric. You know what I mean? Cause I saw the big man not writing bars. And that's this is part of why I said I knew I was fearless or up for a challenge. I saw the big man not write bars, and I'd heard about this from like Wayne and Jay, and I saw him not do it. And he's like, he's just like drawing pictures, and I say, yeah, this is it. Like, you know what I mean? I was just like, okay.
Did you adopt that?
Yeah, I didn't do the drawing pictures. And if I did, it was in my mind, but I didn't write. I didn't write a lyric from that day. You know what I mean?
Oh,
so
wow.
Yeah. So, but I think for me as well, you know, people say that, you know, like, yeah, I don't write bars, but then sometimes it's like the quality. It's all about what we're listening back to. It doesn't really matter. Like, it's a man will say, I didn't write the bars. And I'm just like, well, maybe you should have. You know?
Yeah, we can tell.
Like, yo, we can tell. Do you get what I'm trying to say? So I don't say that to be like, oh my gosh, I don't write. But I think for me and as a creative, when I'm in there, the not writing helps me to enjoy making music more. You know what I mean? Like, I couldn't stand schoolwork. You get me? That's one thing. I wasn't even a bad youth. I just didn't like schoolwork. You get what I mean? And sitting in the corner writing bars when artists would do it, or when I would do it, just reminded me of being in a classroom, like, right. Which is the last thing it's just the worst thing ever. And when I'm doing it in my mind and I'm coming up with a couple of lyrics and I'm walking around the room and spitting the bar to my mate and tapping the engineer and spitting the bar, it's like the studio session becomes the time of my life. Get me? So I just prefer to do it that way, you know. So if you're artist listening to this, don't go, oh, I need to learn to not write. It's just about how the music sounds and what works for you, you get me? Because man, there'll be man out there that'll say they didn't write something and I'm just like, gee.
You should have.
You feel me? Like, so it does really matter. It's about the product, innit, you get me? So, yeah.
Yeah, no, I get that. Are there any songs in particular on the album, maybe one song that you can pick out that really means a lot to you? It's like sentimental.
Yeah, man. But, obviously, there's a few, but I'd definitely say Acceptance, you get me? Because, you know, you can probably tell in the rapping style how conversational it is. It's like, I feel like that embodies what I'm just trying to say when I said you have to be there as a person to make this music. You know what I mean? That's not just about like, oh yeah, he's got sick bars and you hear that wordplay or that thing that he done. It's not, you know what I mean? It's me really expressing my growth and perspectives as a artist, as a human through my artistry, should I say, you get me? So I'd say Acceptance, definitely, man. Just sort of Acceptance at the beginning of, you know, growth, like, you get me? You ain't going nowhere till you can accept your circumstances and do something about them, you know what I mean? So I think putting that at the end was just poetic, because it's like, you know, everything started from there for me. When I say change your mind, change your life, you gotta accept your circumstances for what they are. And, you know, be prepared to sort of do something about them. Take responsibility, like I said earlier to my powers, like, you know, the reason why we have to take responsibility for everything is because it gives you the ability to respond, you get me? Mm-hmm. Without it, you're powerless. But I want to make shit my fault, mm-hmm. no matter what happened. I got to find a way to make it my fault, and that way I can grow from it and progress from it. And it's not just a waste of a, you know what I mean? Then it's not a waste of a situation.
I've been trying to adopt that mindset this year. My word of the year, I don't know if you realize, Chris. Mm-hmm. Accountability.
Come on.
There we go.
I've been using this word a lot this year. Honestly, like, once you become more accountable of everything in your life, your life becomes a lot easier. Like, genuinely, it becomes a lot easier. You're not victim. You're not playing victim. You're not blaming others. Mm-hmm. Say it was my fault, rectify it, move forward, grow.
Yep.
You're only going to get better.
You're only going to get better, literally. You know? And that's, you know, essentially what will keep us in a good place spiritually, mentally, you know what I mean? You got to keep making progress, keep growing, keep, you know what I mean? Exactly what she said just now, you know?
Let's talk about one key thing, going back towards the album.
Yeah.
One thing you've been very strong on is that regardless of the release, post the release, you've still been very active in promoting it, pushing it. And we're in a day and age now where a lot of artists will go absolutely harambe, firstly, for that first week sales. They'll be very active, the pop-up shops, the launch parties, the posts on social media, the sponsored ads. And then once the first weeks pop up, nothing. Mm-hmm. Now, regardless, despite the fact that you've spent months recording this, for some people even a year plus recording this, do you feel pressured in that sense of where you feel like, okay, after the first weeks, the pressure's off me now? Or do you feel like, no, there's life in this, I'm gonna continue? Like, you still need to listen to this.
Jeez, like, pressure from where, dog? Like, bro, like, man, put my life into this shit. You know what I mean? My life, bro. Like, everything. Resources, funds, everything. To the point of, like, just, hey, bro. To the point of spending, what was it, 6 weeks in Los Angeles just mixing it. You know what I mean? With shout out to David Kim. You know, like, the other side of the world, just to get the sound right. Like, how can I, week one pressures of what pressure? Like, you know what I mean? Like, I made something that I felt meant something, not only to me, but to the times I'm living in and my people. And I want that to live forever. So how can I kind of just leave it to a week when I've made it for forever? You know what I mean?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
But that's just personally.
Yeah, but do you think artists have got into a habit of doing that though? We do see it a lot. There is so much promo in the run up and maybe that first week, and then afterwards they kind of just let it slide. And I think it was even made you think that. I think highlighted this to on his page about months back. He said it. I think he was referencing Diddy, and he was like, Diddy put a song like months back, and he was still promoting it. And he was like, why don't we do that more here? Like he's still promoting it because it's his song. He made it. Why not?
Yeah. You're right. I think I don't really see much of what's going on, if I'm honest.
Mm.
But I think maybe it'd be easier. This is just thinking off the top of my head. Maybe it'd be easier to do that when you've like given everything. Maybe we don't give everything to all the music we make. Maybe the fact that you never gave everything to it and you just made it, and the same sort of swag or attitude or mentality to create is the same that you deliver on sort of putting it out. You know what I mean?
Mm.
I think, because I'm only saying that because the fact that I put so much into it means that it's impossible for me to treat it any other way. You get me? So maybe it's only the natural sort of progression from kind of making it in that way as well. Just go studio, bam, 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 bam. Yeah, project, love, drop that, keep it moving. So I guess maybe it's correlates with how man made it or how man put it together. You get me? So
yeah, I get what you're saying.
That's a thought. You get me? That might not be the answer. You get me? Because I haven't really pre'd each person's release and how they, but that's just what came to my mind after what you just asked. You get me?
100%. And then you even see it as like you took a, an orthodox approach with the album, with the release of Champion. And correct me if I'm wrong, was that just after you'd won?
Yeah.
Did you know already that you was gonna win this?
No, but the man upstairs knows everything. You know what I mean? So I feel like, you see, I feel like one of the worst things you can do to yourself is not believe in God. It doesn't make sense, bro. Call it what you want to call it, mate. I'm not fast. You know what I mean? Call it God, call it the universe, call it whatever you want to call it. Call it, that's fine. But to not, to think that we're as high as it gets, you're probably as high as it gets. You know what I mean? Like, you feel what I'm trying to say? Like, and it's because when you do, it just makes everything much easier. Everything just becomes easier. Like, things are less confusing and it's just easier to navigate your way to your dreams and your goals. Everything's easier. You know what I'm talking about.
I really do.
So, if you're sitting there thinking, oh, there's no such thing, listen, show me proof, bro. There's proof everywhere, bro. There's proof in the fact that, I don't know, bro, the fucking planets never come out of sync.
Yeah.
Every fucking, what do you call them?
No, molecules. Honestly, do you ever just look at the sky? Like,
do you get what I'm trying to say? The proof, there's not more proof of anything else than that.
How was this all created? Like, surely, you feel me? Surely there has to be something above
us. Exactly.
And how it all just stays in position.
Everything.
Everything works.
Every blade of grass, everything. And it's like, that thing is cleverer than me. You, all of us, is cleverer.
Yeah.
And man's got access to his cleverness. You know what I mean? So a lot of the time, even when we're making music, creating, boom, boom, it's easy to be, deep down, we're all humble as creators, bro, because we know that it's not all us, bro. You know what I mean? When we get a hunch, when we get inspiration, we know that's not us in it, you get me? So I think it just makes it easier. And so I kind of went off on a tangent, but just with what you said, seems a bit too poetic, that release, like coming at that time. But we kept having to push the release back for XXX reason. And it just so happened that
it happened that
day that we locked in was the day of the award week and the day that we won that. And then, you know what I mean?
It just seems poetic. So well.
Yeah, but that's, and I don't take credit for that at all, no.
Even down towards the people that you recruited for it. I mean, Tef, that's the first time you guys have worked with each other since Blood, Swag and Tears.
Yeah, it's
and
been a
since,
minute.
Like, GMO.
Yeah, it's been a minute. So I got a couple of tunes with Tef, actually. So it's surprising. But yeah.
Because it feels like, that literally was like the last time when you two worked with each other.
I guess.
Then Blanco, the first. Why is it those two that you chose specifically for that one?
One, because I know them. I like making music with people I know, you got me? And they're like barers, like they're sick rappers, bro. Do you know what I mean? The lyrical content is very, I respect it a lot, you know what I mean? Both of them. And yeah, I wanted to bring a couple of sick lyrics together to sort of champion the rhythm, you know what I mean? Pun intended, absolutely, for sure. You get me? And Blanco's sick, bro. Blanco's facts. He's sick, bro. Like, he's just like a painter, Blanco. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. He makes madness sound so artistic and abstract. You know what I mean?
Proper North Oxford.
Yeah. He's cold. You know what I mean? So the pair of them, it wasn't too much for. I just thought I want two sort of quality lyricist rappers on there, and those two came to mind. I got a good relationship with them. It wasn't too complicated to make it happen.
Is it hard now with securing various collaborations? Because correct me if I'm wrong, and please do, you still might be the only person who has a tune with Skepta and Stormzy on the table. Let's give more accolades. You know what I mean? We could do more of that.
Right, yes.
That
is
funny. Which was a FIFA sync as well.
Yes.
Literally.
Econ it, Chris.
You might be the only person that's done that, to be fair.
That is joke, you know? And to be fair, even at the time, I was a bit like, okay, we're doing this. You know what I mean? But I guess maybe no one's actually just tried. You know what I mean? I remember I just had the tune there and I hit Skep. I was speaking with Skep. And who did I speak with first? No, I can't remember who I spoke with first. Obviously, Storms is my boy. Mm. So I remember Storms was just like, when I hit him about the song, he's like, Av, I don't even want to hear the song. I'm coming studio. Just tell me when I'm recording on the song. You know what I mean? And he done what he said. I don't know if I spoke with Skep beforehand. I can't remember who I spoke with first. I just hit Skep. It was on FaceTime. I was like, yo, I got this tune here. Boom, 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 boom. Sent him the song. He's like, yeah, this is crazy. Boom, boom, boom. And I'm like, oh, I feel like I've got Stormzy on it. And then he called me back. I'm just like, yeah, cool. Link me on this day. Let's do it. You know? And it wasn't too complicated. The boys didn't interact at the time. Because we didn't shoot it, our timings didn't match in terms of filming the video. Mm-hmm. So, you know, hopefully the world gets to see them two link up again. I think that'd be sick.
Definitely. Absolutely. I mean,
definitely.
Yeah.
And even down towards collaborations, is there anyone that's still left there on the list? Because I feel like you've ticked them now, where you've had the Getzes.
Yeah,
the
you got Wretches, a solid roster.
The Skeptics. Is there anyone else that's still remaining that you look at and think, I still need a collaboration with them?
I don't look at anyone in that way, if I'm honest. I do have artists that I'd love to work with. Mm. You know, artists like, you know, North London's very own James Blake.
Oh, bad boy.
You know, artists like, you know, Kendrick Lamar, J. Cole. Mm-hmm. Obviously, top, top artists, aren't they? Artists like, you know, who else comes to mind all the time? Obviously, Frank Ocean would be great. There's a lot of artists. I just want to get in the studio with them. Massive Attack, I want to get in the studio with them and see what happens. There's artists, you know, there's artists, I guess, that in my mind, I'm like, yeah, I'd love to work with them. I don't feel like, oh, this is on my wish list. No one ain't on my wish list, you get me? But I like to get back in the studio with Little Sims. I ain't been in the studio with Little Sims since I was about 14 or 15 years old.
That would be very, you know what I mean?
She's a beautiful friend of mine, you get me? So I would like to do that. I told her the other day, I'd like to get in the studio with Annie as well. I really like Annie.
Yes.
Cold. She's sick.
She also won an award as well.
You know what I mean?
Exactly. Yeah.
So I think the pair of them are brilliant, you get me?
Amazing.
So Sims actually brought me to like my first ever sick studio. You know what I mean? Her and her big brother used to sort out sessions, and I remember going to the studio we was using. I was like, yo, this is crazy. You know what I mean? I'm recording in my bridging's wardrobe. You get me?
And I saw the soundboard and said, brother, this is mad.
Yeah, you get me? So, Sims, I'd like to work with Sims again soon.
Dope. But before we wrap up, I try and refrain from asking artists, like, well, this is what I'm going to try and practice, like, what's next? Because I just actually don't really like that question anymore. I just don't think it's fair. I think it's just too much pressure, personally, because I hate when people ask me that. Yeah. So I'm like, why should I then do the same to others?
Yeah.
So treat people how you want to be treated. Instead, I want to say, is there anything else you'd like to share with us and your fans?
Man.
That's the better question.
First of all, you know what I mean? I'd like to say thanks for having me. You get me? It's a pleasure. Second of all, anything I'd like to share, I'd like to share my album once again. Yes. Get pluggy.
Yeah.
I mean, God Save the Streets out now. It's my debut album. You know, executive produced by 3-2 The Icon. You know, listen to it, stream it, tell a friend to tell a friend to tell another friend who goes and tells another friend, hopefully. And then they come back and tell you, not knowing that you started the whole thing. You get me? And yeah, in terms of what, you know, maybe I put out some more music before the close of the year. Mm-hmm. I'm still figuring it out as much as you might be behind the screen, you get me? So that's it really, man. You get me? We're here, man.
Nice. Oh, what's this?
Do you know what I'm really happy about though? What happened there?
We've got the funniest question to ask you.
Go on, go for it. You ask the question first.
All right, before we do wrap up. Online, we've been seeing this race debate that's going on.
Oh.
Don't worry. You and Storms, who's faster out of you two? And who would generally win a 100-meter track? 100-meter track race.
Do you know?
I'm afraid it gets in there as well. Because yeah. I think it was you three that were going back and forth about this.
Yeah,
I would love to see it.
I see a Gets video. Gets was moving. Mad, like, it's moving. I'm like, okay.
Yeah.
And Jamaicans, man. Damn. Jamaicans, man. I don't understand how. Facts. You know what I mean? But in terms of Storms, you know, I remember seeing him at Glasgow and we was getting at it backstage. And it's like, look, if I'm honest, I've raced him a long time ago. You know what I mean? It was a long time ago, to be fair. Yeah. And, you know, it was a beautiful win, of course.
Mm-hmm.
You know, very beautiful win. So time's gone by, you know. The boy has been training. You know, so maybe things would be different today. But just like you guys, just like people seeing us go back and forth, I'd love to see what if that actually would be the case, if things would be different, you know. I'd back myself all day long, you know. He's a strong brother. He's been training hard.
Yeah.
So it'll be interesting to see for sure. Gets? Jesus. Don't get me wrong, I'll breeze him, but Jesus. I see Jamaica, I don't get it. Like, how's that one small island? You look so fast.
So powerful, innit?
I don't get it.
I feel like as if we need this as a scene, we need a sports day.
Yeah.
We definitely need a sports day.
I'll just be the ref.
Yeah, we do. So I can sprint at all of these, man.
I'm time around for the train.
You got this. Oh, you got this, man. Somehow, somewhere.
Rounders. Yeah, there we go.
Something.
Maybe you can train up for it, you get me?
Oh, why not, God. Man? I have no intention of doing that.
I hear that. Still, do you know what I'm happy about? I'm happy that this guy never mentioned no football.
Oh, come on, man. I also want to do that.
Man, you.
What's that?
Oh, okay.
What's that again?
Never said anything.
No, do you know what? I'll never deny my team on camera.
Oh, look at him now.
Never. I take that back.
Circling back, I see.
Before we close, all I'm going to say is the great Manchester United will be back. And when we are, I will be there. Okay. Trust me.
Okay. You was there at 7? No, you wasn't.
Nah. That was meant to be the closing moment, bro.
Oh, fair enough.
Do you get what I'm trying to say?
This is the like, share, comment, subscribe
bro,
part.
I'm trying to add, bro. Like, yo.
Av, thank you so much.
I appreciate thank you. So you. Much thank you guys for down. Having me.
God Save the Streets out.
Cheese.
Right now, let's please make it. Sure you continue buying, streaming, supporting every single time.
Come on, man, love.
It's been the Control Room.
Yes, thank you guys once back. Again. Av, thanks once again.
Thanks for having
it's
me.
It's a pleasure
still.
Having you in our company. It's always a good time.
Come on.
Make sure you like, comment, share, subscribe, all of that good stuff. It's the Control Room.